Does the Israelite exodus from the Pharaoh of Egypt, as portrayed in the Bible, actually have any archaeological or historical legitimacy? Opinions vary, but stay tuned as we investigate, and we will conclude whether this is fact or just more folklore. So did the ancient Israelites really wander in the wilderness for 40 years in a mass exodus escaping the Pharaoh of Egypt until they finally settled into the Promised Land, back then known as Canaan, in which today represents modern-day Israel? And today, the area of Canaan would have included the West Bank, Gaza, Jordan, and southern portions of Syria and Lebanon. And scholars vary on when they actually think this migration took place, some believing 15th century before Christ and some believing more in the 13th century. And these numbers may not seem significant at first, but they are when you correlate them with the level of power in those times with the Egyptian dynasties ruling. And if you look at one of my sources of BibleArchaeology.org, it'll give you the fundamentalist view of it, as the author of that article specifically states that he believes the Bible is the divine word of God, in that we should use the Bible to interpret all archaeology found, not the other way around. And of course, I read his input and immediately disregarded it, because you don't use the Bible to explain archaeological finds. The archaeology is the evidence, plain and simple. So that's not the route I'm going to go to try to investigate whether this 40-year wandering in the wilderness actually occurred with what would have been a few million people. And this brings us to our first point. The Egyptian population during that time was anywhere from 2 to 5 million people. They believe that the Israelite population of people living in the area would have been anywhere from 1 to 3 million. And these people were not all congregated in one place, like the story of Exodus and Moses portrays. And why would so many people be hanging out in this area? Because the Nile River running north to south was known for having high floodplains, which gave for very fertile harvests. And of course, in that time period, your survival ability and sustainability depended largely on what you can grow in a vastly desert country. So there was a mixture of Canaanites, Israelites, and Egyptians, all scattered through this vast kingdom. Now, Exodus specifically states that 600,000 men, along with women and children, was the number that escaped the Pharaoh. So at the very least, if each man averaged one wife and one child, that's still almost 2 million people. That's at the very least, and that's probably greatly underestimated. And of course, per the fable, they were fed by manna and quail. And if you're going to believe that billions of quail were provided by God over this time period, then I guess you are. I'm not. Not to mention that there's a problem of the water supply, which would have been millions of gallons a day. And I measured the distance from the border of Egypt to even as far north as Jerusalem, and it was about 700 and so kilometers. And that's bird's eye view. And they couldn't have done that because they would have had to cross the Nile and then cross the Gulf of Suez, which in those times would have been impossible for over 2 million people. So if they shot north to the area of what is now Cairo and worked north around the Nile and then around the Gulf of Suez, that journey would have been just over 1,000 kilometers, or approximately 700 miles. And at the slow traveling of even 15 miles a day, it would have taken a month and a half. And of course, we know why they didn't just enter the land of Canaan. Because according to biblical tradition, they didn't trust God for their safety as they saw Canaan as heavily fortified. And God punished them for their lack of faith by making them wander the wilderness for 40 years. This 2 million people needing millions of gallons of water a day. I'm sorry, but that story just doesn't logistically add up. Now, as for trying to prove that there may have been smaller migrations, exoduses if you will, the scholars have varying opinions, and this includes when it actually happened. Many believe that these migrations took place approximately 1200 BC. Professor William Dever, former director of the Albright School of Archaeological Research and a highly regarded biblical scholar, states that there is no direct evidence that the ancient Israelites were massively enslaved, as portrayed in the Book of Exodus. And this seems to be the consensus among most scholars. It is stated that there were 97 new villages found in the central hills of Canaan, and they can differentiate these villages from older villages by the type of pottery that they've uncovered. And there's also an indication by a historical stone left by the pharaoh Merneptah in approximately 1230 BC, which does name in hieroglyphics the word Israel. And interestingly enough, another determinant sign of hieroglyphics, which names them as a people versus a city, as everything else is named a city on the stone except for them, indicating that they haven't settled down at that time period. And there is the historical evidence of the pharaoh Ramses, who built a huge administrative city in the northeast of the Nile Delta. That area will be designated Goshen in the Bible, where Israelites did live in Egypt. And Ramses was known for conscripting foreign labor. Now, slavery was very common in that time. There were slaves that were bought and slaves that were captured during various wars. It's probable that there were probably some Israelites that were slaves and involved in building of that city. But there's no indication that the entire Israelite population was enslaved. Now, the Egyptian dynasty was declining in power around 1200 BC as well. And Canaan had a very intimate relationship with Egypt in the height of its power, a power that was dwindling, which may give cause of why there was a migration or multiple migrations of Israelites into that area. So these pro-Exodus arguments might give rise to the authenticity to one or many migrations of Israelites from Egypt to what is today Israel, former land of Canaan. But it's not the way Exodus portrayed it. First of all, we're able to identify almost none of the stops on the Exodus. That's why the various routes have been hypothesized instead of being constructed as fact. But the most important stop, where the Israelites supposedly resided for 38 out of the 40 years of wandering, was in the area of Kadesh Barnea, in the surrounding area of the Sinai Peninsula. And the problem with the legitimacy of the Book of Exodus' story is that this area has been excavated to the nth degree, and they have found absolutely no archaeological evidence whatsoever indicating any ancient Israelite habitation prior to the 10th century BC, during the time of Solomon. There's also the problem of the conquest of cities that the supposed Israelites conquered in quick military campaigns upon entering Canaan. For instance, in the city of Jericho, the Israelites supposedly marched around the massive walls for approximately 7 days in a psychological warfare stunt until the wall collapsed, in which they took the city. The problem is that the city of Jericho was largely active in the 16th century before Christ and was largely abandoned by the time the Israelites got to it in the 13th century. Now, there was a professor, John Benson, from the Trinity College in England, who suggested that maybe the date of approximately 1200 BC wasn't when the Exodus took place, but more 1500 BC, when Jericho would have been populated. Well, the problem with this is there was no evidence of the Israelites being in Canaan at all until 200 years later. And there's a problem that Egypt was a far too powerful dynasty in 1500 BC than it was in its declining power in 1200 BC. And there's the same problem with the city of Ai, the second city that the Israelites conquered. There was no city at the end of 13th century BC, and the ancient Israelites weren't there prior, as this Professor Benson tries to hypothesize. And there's also the problem of the Sinai Peninsula, that we haven't found any grave sites of these ancient Israelites, and there should have been massive numbers of graves for approximately even 2 million people, and that's a low estimate, that lived in this area for 40 years before entering the land of Canaan. Now, the fundamentalist argument was that these bodies were scattered, as Paul wrote later in Corinthians, so therefore we wouldn't expect to find any graves whatsoever. And again, you can't use a verse in the Bible that we don't know who wrote for sure, as we have no originals of Corinthians, and the fact that it was written well after the event. We have to go by evidence, and the fact is we just don't have it. What the consensus of most scholars is, outside of the fundamentalists, is that yes, there was a slow migration of Israelites from the Egyptian area to the land of Canaan, which part of which became modern-day Israel today. There's no indication that it was a massive migration of millions of people let go and then later pursued by one pharaoh, but occurred over several hundred years. And there's many, many unanswered questions about the specifics. How big were these migrations? What routes did they use? And how many they were? And it's difficult to put a finger on because the Israelites were such a nomadic people to begin with. But the one thing that we can pretty much say for sure is that it wasn't just one mass exodus of several million people. But due to the logistical impossibilities of this massive movement, the inaccuracies of the cities they supposedly conquered when they entered the land of Canaan, and the fact that there is no evidence of a massive enslavement of the entire Israelite population while in Egypt, clearly points that, like the story of Noah, the book of Exodus is largely made up of folklore and fable. But if you'd like to read something that's not a fable, check out my novel, The Second Fall, an offbeat apocalypse sure to offend the fundamentalist. On Amazon, see the link in the video description as well as the banner, and I will see you next time as we once again take the sword of reason and reality and thrust it right through the heart of ignorance.